Queens Public Library continues to celebrate its 125th anniversary. Don't forget to browse our book list and share your QPL story. For more information, visit qpl125.org. Begin 2022 with a library card. Get access to all of our materials, including books, ebooks, e-magazines, music, movies, and more. Our digital media options, which includes ebooks, music, and more, are available from anywhere with an internet connection. Try Hoopla, our new streaming service connecting you to movies, TV shows, and comics. Martin Luther King Jr. Day is on January 17th. To honor the civil rights icon, we have special programs and recommended reading. Visit queenslibrary.org to learn more and explore all of these opportunities.
Welcome to Queens Public Library. My name is Mark and I'm a children's librarian at MassPef. And if you enjoyed today's program, check out our next program on January 20th at 4 p.m. It's a wrap, DIY plastic-free fruit food wraps. Check the comments where we'll be putting links for those events so you can set a reminder. These programs are made possible by the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Parks Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. Now for today's event, bird anatomy, beaks and feet. From hummingbirds to toucans to chickens, birds have all kinds of different beaks and feet. Why don't they all look the same? Danielle Sherman from New York, NYC, Audubon will show us why birds have different types of beaks and feet and how they use these adaptations. Take it away, Danielle.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you so much. Hi, everyone. I am Danielle and I work for the New York City Audubon Society. And like Mark said, we are here today to talk about bird beaks and feet. We have our lovely lovely puffin here eating some fish. You can see his wonderful beak and his wonderful feet, and we'll be talking about him in a little while. Now, let's see. Birds have all different types of beaks. How many different beaks can you spot? Here are a bunch of different types of birds. And actually, if you look a little closer at each of these wonderful birds, you might notice that they all pretty much have different types of beaks. Why do we think they all have different beaks? This is something that maybe you can all think about for a little bit. From our mallard with the kind of duck bill, we might call it a bill or a beak, they have a different beak. Then we have our bobolink over here, which is a type of grassland bird. And he, you can see he has kind of almost a triangle or wedge-shaped beak. Then we have our bald eagle with that kind of hooked bird of prey beak that lots of our birds of prey, like hawks or eagles or owls, have that kind of sharp hooked beak. And then we have our cerulean warbler, which is a type of songbird that we see in New York during the spring and the fall, and has a tiny, tiny little beak that's kind of pointy almost, maybe you can see. Then we have a red-bellied woodpecker, which has maybe a sort of still pointy but longer, thicker bill. And then our egret with its very, very long, kind of sharp-looking beak there. And then our pelican with its big bill, all kind of puffed up on the bottom. Maybe he's got some food in there. And then our American oyster catcher with its long orange beak there as well. These are so many different types of bills and beaks. Maybe some of them look a little similar to the others. You might notice or wonder certain things about these beaks. Maybe we look at these beaks and we think, well, why does the oyster catcher have this long one while the mallard has a sort of more flat duck beak? Why does the pelican have such a big bill? Why does the raptor have a pointy, the eagle, why does he have a pointy, sharp bill? There are lots of questions that we can ask ourselves about all of these different beaks that we see. So for right now, to help us answer some of our questions about bird beaks, we are going to play a game called Hungry Bird. You are all going to be hungry birds, and this is something that you can do with me now, or you can do this later at home. It's kind of a game, but it's also an experiment. So you can do this as many times as you like on your own. You only need a few things. The first thing you need are some beaks. Now, your beaks can be kind of anything around your home that you think might be able to pick up food. Utensils like a spoon, which I have here, or maybe a fork would be a good option. I also have a pair of chopsticks, which I like using, and I think that would be a really good option for picking up some of our food as well. I also went ahead and got myself a silicone straw because I think that might be helpful for certain types of food also. So these are just some ideas that I had. You might have a fork. Maybe you have some other things around your house that you think would be good for picking up food, but these are some things that I had. So you can get those things. Now, something else you need is food. So for your food, you can have any small object from around your house. I have here, I have some buttons, just a bag of little buttons. I also have a bunch of dice. Maybe you have some dice or tokens from a board game or any other type of game around your house. I won't use it today, but beans are good. These are some large white beans, but dry beans. We don't want any wet beans for this activity, but any kind of dry, maybe rice would be a really good option too. I also have a cup of water, which we're gonna talk about in a little bit, but I thought water might be interesting for reasons that we'll talk about later, but that could be kind of an interesting thing to use. And then you also need something to hold your food. So I have a little plate here. You could use a bowl or, for my water, I have a cup, clearly. And then you need something to put your food in. So I have a second cup here. You could also use a bowl. We're going to call this our stomach. This is going to be what we're feeding with our stomach here. So what we're going to do is I'm going to put my... I have my buttons in this plate right now. Maybe you can kind of see. And we are going to have 20 seconds to try to feed ourselves in our cup right here. Okay. So you're going to pick your beak. I'm going to pick this spoon first. Then I'm going to get lots of food and I'm going to put lots and lots of food on my plate here because I'm really hungry. I'm a really hungry bird. So I have lots of my buttons in my plate. And then I'm going to give myself 20 seconds to see how many I can get into my stomach, how quickly I can feed myself. So I'm going to put on a timer right now because I can't eat and time myself at the same time. But if you have someone to time you, maybe they can call it out for you how many seconds you have. We're going to do 20 seconds, okay? So here we go. When I say start, we can all go together. Okay, 1, 2, 3, start. Okay, here we go. I'm going to try to feed myself. Go as quickly as you can. Try not to knock anything over. Try to use just one hand and your utensil. I was trying not to use both of your hands, just your utensil. And we're out of time. That was 20 seconds, believe it or not. And as you can see here, I got quite a few of my buttons in here. It looks like I got, oh gosh, it's too many to count, but I want to say maybe 40 buttons in here. So that was our first experiment. So with the spoon, let's say we can kind of see I got it up to this line on my stomach. So I'm going to try one more time, but this time, instead of using my spoon as my beak, I'm going to try using my chopsticks instead. Same amount of time, 20 seconds. We're going to try to get as many buttons so we have the same food, same amount of time. The only thing that's different is I'm using chopsticks instead of the spoon. So let's see how this goes. So I'm going to start 20 seconds right now on my timer. And we'll all start at the same time, okay? Ready, set, go. All right. Oh, dear. This is already harder. I am already having a much harder time. I don't know about everyone else. And maybe while we're doing this, we notice the chopsticks can only, for me at least, pick up my food kind of one at a time. So with my spoon, oh, and that was 20 seconds already. So I don't know if you could tell, I got so much less food this time. I maybe only got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of my food in here. Now, we might think that that is telling us that chopsticks are not as good at getting our food as the spoon is. However, if we try this experiment with different types of food, we might find that different beaks are really good at getting certain types of food versus other beaks. So for example, I just put my dice here in this tray instead of my chopsticks. And I'm not going to go through it all again because we don't really have that much time, unfortunately. But if you try it with dice, for example, when I'm doing this with my dice, I can kind of only get, my spoon is kind of small. It's not as good as at picking up the dice as it is with the buttons. So I can really only get one dice at a time. Maybe my chopsticks are actually kind of better at picking up the dice since they're big and square. My chopsticks are actually really good at picking up the dice, except I'm slipping. But you might try it with different types of food and different types of beaks. Now, another interesting experiment might be actually trying to get your food out of a cup instead of the plate. If you're trying to get your food out of a cup, maybe the spoon will be kind of helpful, or maybe it'll be kind of hard to get it out of the cup as you're, you know what I mean? Like to dip in there. But the chopsticks actually might be really good at getting all the way down into your cup and getting the food out of the bottom. So it's interesting to try different combinations and see which beaks are good at getting which food into your stomach. Now, something else that I thought was interesting is we were talking, Mark mentioned at the beginning, hummingbirds. Now, what do hummingbirds eat? If we have, let's say that our buttons, let's say they're seeds or some other type of food, but hummingbirds, they stick their beaks into a flower, right? And they drink nectar out of that flower. Now, I have my water here, my spoon, maybe it can get a little bit of water at a time out of my very narrow cup that I have here. But if you look, I decided that maybe it would be a little easier to try to use a straw. And using the straw and my finger over the hole of the straw, I actually can get pretty fast at feeding myself my liquid, my water, you might be able to see, and putting it into my stomach that way. So this is an interesting experiment for you to keep trying at home, and to kind of try to figure out what utensils or beaks are best at getting what type of food. Now, if we can go back to the slideshow, thank you so much. This might give us a little bit of food for thought. If you are trying this experiment at home, which beak helped you eat more food more quickly? Maybe would this beak work with other types of food? Have you tried other types of food? And again, this is all in quotes, right? Because this is kind of, you know, where you were using buttons and dice and things like that. But this kind of helps us understand that beak shape is an adaptation to help birds eat. Now, when we say adaptation, we mean some kind of feature, something about the way an animal is shaped, something that they can do maybe that helps them in the wild, helps them eat or survive a little bit better. So our birds have all of these different beaks so that they can adapt to their type of food. It may also change, like we saw with our different shapes, right? It was easier to get certain foods when we were using the flat plate versus when we had the cup. It might also depend how these birds are eating, where they're getting their food from. If you're a bird and you have to get into a pine cone in order to get your food, your beak might look different versus if you're eating just a seed that's on, let's say, some grass or in a flower or something like that. It's a little harder to get into that pine cone, right? So that might change how your beak looks. We could also have different, if we are a bird that eats clams maybe or oysters, we might have to get into that oyster. We might have to have a beak that can break open that oyster or crack open that oyster shell, or like our hummingbird friends with their long thin beaks, they got to get into that flower, right? Our narrow opening to get that food inside for them, that nectar. So it might just depend on our bird and what they need to do with that beak. It might change that shape for them to make it a little easier. Now, I've spent all of this time talking about beaks and how they're adaptations, but what about feet? What about our bird feet? Now, here are some lovely bird feet for you and birds doing different things with their feet. Feet are also an adaptation. They might change based on what a bird needs to do with their feet. So here are some wonderful feet examples. We see our marsh wren is clinging onto those rushes with his feet, those big grasses with his feet. And then we have our blue-footed boobies, which not only need their feet to get around, you know, you have your webbed feet so that you can get around in the water maybe, but they also use their blue feet as part of a mating ritual. So it's a different type of adaptation. It's not just about getting around. It's also about finding a mate. And then lastly, we have our raptor, our red-tailed hawk or bird of prey over here. And he has those clawed feet that are good for catching prey, right? So there are many different types of things. The bird of prey needs it to eat. He uses his feet to help him eat versus maybe mating, or getting around in the water, or with our marsh wren kind of clinging to a perch. So there are lots of different things that we can do with our feet if we are a bird, and what we need to do will change how our feet are shaped or maybe what they look like. Now, let's play a little matching game. We are going to see if we can match each of these birds with their feet. So you can write down your answers yourself. We have A, B, C, D birds, and then we have their feet, 1, 2, 3, 4. So see if you can match your letter with your number. I'll give you a little time. You might be able to figure it out just based on the photo, but see if you can figure it out. Maybe think about if you know the bird, what it might need to do with its feet, or what might make sense for that bird. If, you know, you think the bird is big or small, what kind of feet it might need to have. I'll give you all a few more moments. And now let's see our match. So we have a few different feet options here. We have our little blue heron. And the interesting thing about the little blue heron is that it is a wading bird. So the little blue heron might stalk through water looking for prey. And what's interesting about that is that the feet, I don't know if you can see, but they're not webbed like a bird that might swim. They actually have individual toes, but they are big, which help the bird kind of wade through the water, right? And then walk on sort of the muddy bottom of their water source, the sandier muddy bottom, and not kind of, you know, they can kind of slowly walk through, maybe not disturb their prey as they kind of, you know, go through with those big but not webbed feet, right? Because if they had webbed feet, they might splash, 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 splash in the water as they were trying to move through. But because they have the no webbing in the individual toes, they can kind of right through the water like that. And then next here, we have our snowy owl. Now our snowy owl, you might be able to see, has talons or claws. So those sharp bird of prey talons that we were talking about earlier, which help it to capture its prey, it does eat small mammals, so it might help it to kill those prey as well. And you'll also notice that it has all these fluffy covering over its feet as well, because our snowy owl often lives up in the Arctic for much of the year or in other cold places. And then we have our mallard over here. I say it's a male mallard because earlier we saw female mallards, which were brown and streaky. This beautiful bird is a male mallard with its green head, wonderful, and it has our classic webbed duck feet, and you will see webbed feet in lots of types of ducks or other waterfowl that need to swim, because it's like having those swim flippers on, right? It really helps it kind of get through the water to swim around and also to get food. And then lastly, we have our wonderful scarlet tanager here, which is a type of songbird that we also see in New York in the fall and in the spring as well. This is actually a male scarlet tanager, which it has this beautiful red color here. And you can see that our scarlet tanager spends a lot of its time in trees. So it is going to need kind of nimble or little feet that can cling to a tree branch. Like you can see in this photo, it's kind of hanging on to that little tiny tree branch. And a lot of our birds that spend their time in trees, like songbirds, but also birds that you might be a little bit more familiar with, like maybe a cardinal or a sparrow, those birds are also going to have feet that are adapted for perching in trees. So it's kind of interesting to think about maybe where the bird lives when we think about their feet. Do they need to be in the water? Do they need to be in a tree? Maybe they spend a lot of time on the ground. There are some birds that spend a lot of their time on the ground, actually, like the snowy owl, for example. What do they need to do? Where do they need to live with those feet? Where do they need to be? But then also, what do they need to do with the feet? Are the feet helping them capture prey or get food? What else do the feet need to do? Are there other things that, do they need to be quiet in the water, like our little blue heron, for example? So there are many different ways that our birds are adapted to help them survive in the wild that have to do with their feet and also with their beaks. And that is all that I have for you all today. There are lots of other wonderful birds with very interesting beaks and feet, and I'm sure you can learn more about those and find out a little bit more information. If you have any questions, I am happy to answer them. I don't see any, but if you do, you can just put them in the chat. I'm not seeing any questions today, but I encourage you all to visit. I think our website link was just put in the chat. You can go there for more information about birds. or just do a little research yourself to find out more about some of the wonderful beaks and feet that there are out there and other wonderful adaptations, because birds have lots of different adaptations. You can learn more about those by doing a little research. And that's all for today, but I hope you all had fun learning about beaks and about feet. Hi, everyone. Oh, hi, Mark.
Okay. First, we would like to give a big thank you to Danielle for the wonderful presentation. We would also like to thank again the Newtown Creek Environmental Benefit Fund, administered by City Park Foundation and funded by the New York State Department of Environmental Conservation. Please like and share this video, as this event will be available for viewing after. In addition, subscribe to the QPL channel to get more updates on similar upcoming programs. Links for replays of upcoming events, replays of past events, or more links related to the Hunters Point Environmental Education Center are in the live chat. Just checking again for any questions. I don't see any questions. So thank you, everyone, for attending today's program. Goodbye. Take care.
Bye. Thanks, everyone.